In late 2010, a Tunisian street vendor, Mohamed Bouazizi, set himself on fire. It was an act of desperation and protest against the government. His action would change the world.
President Ben Ali lost control and fled, his regime suddenly over. The touch paper of revolution had been lit.
Mass civil unrest followed in the country and sparked a wave of protests across North Africa and the Middle East. The Arab Spring.
We are tired. We are tired.
The speed with which the protests spread, catalyzed by social media, caught the world off guard. However, where social media once galvanized Tunisians to take to the streets against their authoritarian government, some say it's now being used to suppress the critics of President Kais Saied, Tunisia's increasingly autocratic leader, and it's leading some people to flee the country altogether.
There was the freedom of speech and expression that was gained out of the revolution, and that has disappeared.
I am Beth Godwin, and this is BBC Trending. In this series, we're exploring how power is used and misused on social media. In this episode, we're looking at social media in Tunisia and its role in tipping the fledgling democracy back into dictatorship.
There were rumours or urban legends of surveillance on social media.
That's Shreya. She's an Indian doctoral scholar in sociology and politics. In 2022, Shreya was living and studying in Tunis, Tunisia's capital city. Though she had heard about online surveillance, as she wasn't a Tunisian, she didn't think anyone would be watching her social media feeds that closely.
I was writing to very few followers on Twitter openly about my just daily experiences of, you know, walking around the markets or a cat I found. It was mostly me posting photographs as a form of like, oh, this is my fieldwork. This is the research I'm doing.
She was waiting to renew her student residency visa and continue her PhD research in the country. It was taking a long time to be granted, and she was facing a wall of bureaucracy.
Again, they had told me that, oh, you know, the residence permit is not ready. Come back in a month, come back in a week, you know, the usual game. So I'm frustrated. When I'm walking out, I see a cat in the corridors of the police station. I take a picture of the cat. I publish a tweet saying that, oh, you know, I'm at the police station again. Again, the residence permit is not ready. Here is a picture of a cat, and it's crying, and I want to cry like the cat. It was something like I was trying to make a joke. It was in English. It was like a most banal tweet I could have written.
Shreya has shown me a screenshot of the tweets. At the police station where my visa is still not ready after a month of submitting papers, she writes, cat stuck, crying in the heat. I want to shout along as well. But her expression of frustration with visa bureaucracy wasn't seen as banal by the Tunisian authorities.
Police persons showed up at my door in plain clothes in Tunis, asked me to bring with me my passport and my temporary residence permit, asked me to follow them to the police station where my passport and my temporary residence permit was taken away from me. I was detained and interrogated. And the reason I was interrogated was because the police interpreted this as quote-unquote critique of their work. So that was the term, this was their phrasing of the tweet. And they asked me to remove it immediately.
Shreya says the police started threatening her.
They started to accuse me of very petty things. They started to make a lot of false charges against me. I think that what they were trying to do is try every way possible to make me look like a criminal.
She told me that this experience was the catalyst for her leaving the country. She's now living in France.
I think right after the incident, I tried to sort of look at it as a minor event, but it was very clear that I was suppressing the fact that the whole situation had changed. They just kept adding charges upon charges, which were completely baseless, but in their framing of things, they were completely valid. I mean, this is the tactic that, you know, that I've heard many Tunisians face as well, or many migrants as well face.
We tried to contact the Ministry of Interior, who are responsible for the police, about Shreya's experience. But they didn't respond. Tunisia's revolution was arguably the most successful of the Arab Spring in terms of a peaceful transition to democracy. But the country is still in crisis, both economically and politically, and the migrant crisis is further undermining stability. Sfax, the second most populous city, has become the main departure point for migrants trying to cross the Mediterranean to Europe. So how did Tunisia go from being on the hopeful path of democracy to here? I turn to my colleague Samia.
I'm Sami Hosni. I work for BBC Monitoring. I'm originally from Egypt. I'm based in the UK, and I've been covering North Africa, and including Tunisia, of course, for over 10 years. Well, at the time, people described the Arab uprisings as the Facebook uprisings or social media uprisings. In fact, social media tools and the use of digital tools enabled the revolutions and accelerated them, particularly in the case of Tunisia. And it's thanks to a small number of activists who spread the word and shared videos and imagery, shocking imagery, actually, of police brutality on Twitter first. And then from Twitter, the protest became like a viral phenomenon. And from there, other waves of protests erupted. And Facebook became the center of online activity, involving probably hundreds of thousands of people, if not millions of people, because Facebook is the most popular platform in Tunisia.
Protests spread to Egypt, Libya, and later on to Yemen, Syria, and the wider Arab world. In its aftermath in Tunisia, new political parties were allowed to be formed, and the country held repeated democratic elections.
After the revolution, Tunisia began a transition to democracy, which involved drafting a new constitution in 2014, and it took years. It enshrined political freedom and civil liberties. So Tunisians enjoyed a high level, an unprecedented level of freedom of expression, online and offline. But of course, the revolution, it produced mixed results. I mean, there were always reports of arrests and prosecutions. So it wasn't a perfect scene, but it was the beginning of a long process towards greater and greater freedom.
But that process is now at a crossroads. The current president, Kais Saied, was elected democratically in 2019, but as time has gone on, critics say he's become more and more autocratic. Anger over the government's handling of the pandemic added to the general unrest over the nation's economic and social turmoil.
So on 24th of July 2021, Kais Saied declared the state of emergency.
Ayman Zaghdoudi works for Access Now, a digital civil rights nonprofit. He's based in Tunis. Here he explains how amidst protest about the economic situation during the pandemic, President Kais Saied consolidated his power. His supporters felt democracy was failing them, but his critics, like Ayman, call it a coup.
So after dismissing the government and freezing the parliament, then he has got like a wide range of power. He become also the head of the general prosecution, and then he can prosecute individuals for like online speech or for any other type of activity. So like all the three branches become like in one hand, the hand of the President of the Republic.
According to Ayman, there are more and more cases of people being arrested or threatened with arrest for posting mild critiques of the government.
So freedom of expression is guaranteed and censorship is banned. However, several laws from the dictatorship era are still valid and being used by the police and the judiciary to prosecute people for what they publish.
That's the sound of a TikTok video showing three young Tunisian men. They are singing a satirical song, periodically laughing as the dark lyrics about life in the country follow along to the theme of the children's cartoon Baba the Elephant. Youssef Chelby and Dia Nissar, two of the people in the video, were arrested in May last year. They faced charges of insulting others through social networks, but were eventually released without charge. The president, Kais Saied, later said in a video on his Facebook page that it was totally unacceptable to arrest two young men who were just singing a song. But when it comes to censorship and surveillance on social media, this sentiment doesn't seem to square up with what's happening in the country. Here's my BBC colleague Samia again.
We've seen a wave of arrests and restrictions on political gatherings, on protests, police brutality against protesters, the silencing of critics, basically since Saied took those so-called exceptional measures to expand his powers. In theory, there is a constitution which actually guarantees freedom of expression, and there is a Bill of Rights. But Saied and his government ignore the constitution.
It's not just those who are directly threatened with arrest who are impacted by the president's crackdown online.
The 10 years in Tunisia between the Arab Spring and Qais Haider's coup were exceptional. We never lived that. We discovered new levels of freedom we didn't expect. The media was absolutely unforgiving with politics, and they were expressing their freedom in every single way. And it was something exceptional, really, in the Arab world.
Amin is a Tunisian journalist who now works as a political strategist in Paris. He was vocal about politics on his social media accounts.
It was crazy. Like, I remember the first debate on TV. There was like 14 presidential candidates. It was really fun to watch. There was so many debates of who won tonight, who was the most aggressive, who was the most presidential. And people were enjoying it online. People were debating a lot about it.
He says the online discussion has changed dramatically since President Kais Saied's power grab.
It was like, so let's go back to the old ways. Let's never talk about politics. Let's never discuss anything. And I think that's what led to people being bullied online too into silence. That's what led to online harassment. We were maybe 10 or 20 people talking online about Kais Saied's coup on a regular basis. And we were heavily targeted. Because we were the only ones talking about it. We were the only ones writing papers about it while being in Tunisia, while being Tunisian. That's what led to our collective harassment.
Amin was subject to threats and doxing from the president's supporters online.
It was never this way. I used to like be very vocal about who I'm voting for, who I'm campaigning for, who I'm siding with in this next election. And of course, there was a lot of humor, of political debates, of jokes. Now it was like death threats. People calling you a traitor, an Islamist, a terrorist.
Amin pointed me towards the accounts of a few influencers who support Saied. He says that they are responsible for whipping up their followers into behaving this way. I asked Samia to take a look.
There are a number of bloggers and media commentators that have a big following on Facebook. One of them is a blogger with over 300,000 followers on Facebook. And his narrative is mostly xenophobic and populist. And he actually recently was critical of Saied for not being harsh enough on critics. There is also a journalist who is a commentator on TV and has over 75,000 followers on Facebook. And he's very, very critical of anti-Saied forces. In one post, he attacked a talk show host for hosting a pro-Israeli guest. He accused him of homosexuality. Homosexuality in Tunisia is a kind of derogatory designation. Comments on his posts contain incitements to attack the host.
Amin said the followers of these influencers would target him too.
People were insulting me, my family. They were putting pictures of people of my family or answering to my tweets with pictures of them, like, we know who they are. And yeah, it was not a great moment to be opposing Saied.
And he told me this was the main reason why he decided to leave Tunisia.
It's not only about jail, it's about how you do your work. Like, I worked with media outlets that let me do whatever I want. Like, they've never pressurized me into saying something or not saying something, etc. So I would never be able to work for Tunisian media outlets in this particular context. It's sad, but it's like the situation for almost every political voice. I have so much respect for people that are still opposing Saied and that are there.
For dissident voices who remain, the online surveillance and censorship on social media is getting worse. And the president has introduced new laws which make it easier to censor and imprison his online critics. One of them is Decree 54, which authorities say aims to fight fake news, online and offline. Supporters say it's important to tackle the spread of false information and rumours. Article 24 of the decree is particularly controversial, though. Critics say it's vague and it carries high penalties for those convicted under it. Amin explains.
It's really crazy. It's really crazy. Defamation, for example, insult, fake news are all sanctioned with 5 years of prison and a fine of £15,000. And in case that the victim is an official, like the President of the Republic or one of his ministers, so the sanction can increase to 10 years of prison and a fine of £30,000.
That's over $38,000. He says cases being brought under this controversial law are on the rise.
We have seen many, many cases related to freedom of expression online. So, for example, the editorial-in-chief of online newspaper, it's called Business News, He wrote an article to express his opinion about the failure of the government to achieve any economic and social gain. And then he was prosecuted based, they consider this article as defamatory.
That case Eamon mentioned is currently ongoing. It's difficult to find accurate figures of how many people are being prosecuted under this law.
The numbers are increasing. The problem that we don't have like official numbers, and it's very hard to track because you can track the numbers with the public personality, for example, journalists, lawyers, political opponent, humorous defenders. But then when you go to the general audience, to the people, it's very hard to track. And I'm 100% sure that the cases are like 10 times more than the number we know related to the public figures.
And when supporters of the president post content that could be deemed illegal as per Decree 54, they don't seem to be targeted in the same way.
There is a sort of double standard when it comes to deal with, for example, Facebook accounts. When it comes to Facebook accounts, sharing propaganda or fake news or defamatory content against political opponent of Kais Saied, no prosecution at all, it's like total immunity. But when it's the other way around, then we see the application of Decree 54.
We approached the Tunisian government for comment on the allegation that Decree 54 is being unfairly targeted toward critics of the government and the president, and the claim that freedom of expression is being suppressed in Tunisia. We also asked them about Shreya's treatment by the police after she tweeted her frustration over the length of time her visa was taking to be granted. They did not respond. Later this year, presidential elections will take place in Tunisia, the third since the Arab Spring and the first since Kais Saied took power. The last parliamentary elections had a record low turnout. Only 9% of eligible voters took part after the main opposition parties boycotted the contest in protest over the president. In the upcoming presidential elections, the stakes are much higher. Eamon says they're critical for the fate of the country.
If we are living in a climate that freedom of expression is not guaranteed, so people are not able to express themselves freely, but also people are not able to receive information freely. And this is going to, of course, deter the climate to have integer, pluralistic and free elections. We need to build the future based on democratic values. That's the first path. Or we're going to continue the current path, and maybe we'll be in a situation similar to the situation before 2011, the date of revolution.
For Shreya, as well as being concerned for Tunisia's democracy, her experience impacted her on a much more personal level too.
It sort of brings out this complete lack of trust in everything and everyone. And so you had rumors of all types, everyone accusing everyone of everything, friendships that dissolved away, which was my case, which was a case for a lot of people. Their close friends became suspicious.
That's it for this episode of BBC Trending's Power Series. A huge thanks to Samia Hosni, Gareth Jones, who mixed this episode, and Trending's editor, Flora Carmichael. If you enjoyed this podcast, please give us a rating or a review. And if you want to get in touch about this episode, then you can do so by emailing me at beth.godwin@bbc.co.uk.